get so like fixated on people not loving me enough or being devoted, and then I become like this sort of I demand like this insane fidelity from my friends.
Well, speaking of mothers,
yeah,
there are no good mothers in this book.
Yeah.
Is that
The library was my space, and there was just so much.
To the Harbor Grace excursion with the boys to have a time.
We're back.
Hello. I think mine's
We're in
on.
Person.
Hello. Oh, mine's
we
working
can hear
too.
You.
Great.
Can you hear? Again, we're all just getting used to interacting with humans again, AV, et cetera. Please put your hand up if you can't hear us. We're going to have about 15, 20 minutes at the end to ask questions. So as we're talking, if something you're like, oh, I wish you'd followed up on that, keep that in your head. We're going to get to you later. So delighted to be here speaking to you about this amazing book. I tore through it. It's a real page-turner. Just fell in love and hate with all of the characters.
Yes.
this is a book about a friendship. A friendship or a relate? I don't even, it's this magnetic connection between these two young girls and then women, and a tragic event disrupts that relationship, and it follows their journey from there and explores issues of class and power and sexuality. That's kind of my overview. I haven't done one of these before with fiction, so I'm very worried about spoilers. So do you have anything else that is a good primer to this discussion that I missed in that overview?
No, it's fine.
Okay.
We'll get into things.
We'll go from there. Okay. Let's start with this this friendship.
Okay.
Because, and I'm sure every single person who reads this book will clock this sentence in the same way. It says, every decent friendship comes with a drop of hatred, but that hatred is like honey in the tea. It makes it addictive. Mm-hmm. Talk to me about this, because that just stuck with me. I like sat at the page for a while as a primer for this relationship between these girls.
So actually originally when I first started the book, I first was working with the characters, and I built up this cast of characters who were all these Victorian girls who are each kind of one based on a character from the French Revolution. So I had my cast of characters, and I didn't know that Marie and Sadie were going to sort of be the sort of principal characters of the book, but it's sort of within their personality that every time I put them on the page, they just took over, and they were just so, they fell in love with each other. And every time they had a scene, because I had originally, I thought they would be antagonists, but they ended up sort of just being wildly in love with each other. And I was like, oh, this is an interesting friendship, and that sort of will be the core of the book. And I don't know, I was just fascinated by relationships and sort of the stuff we don't talk about that makes the relationships in our life really the ones that become obsessive and just totally transform us. And then And it's sort of, as a writer, you kind of go into your own mind, and you never know if, all you can do is be true to yourself, and you don't know if everyone else will have these similar emotions. And you're always like, well, at the end, they'll just say I'm psychotic and pervert and throw the book away. Or others will admit to also having, because if I have them, I've just always loved relationships where I love but hate. Just that competition you have, and the obsession, and the sort of, you're so devoted to them, and everybody else kind of disappears because that person seems so colorful to you. And then at the same time, you me. Constantly, like, want them dead, because, like, then you would be free from this, like, obsession. You would have independence again, and you would stop having to worry about what they were doing and if they were as passionate towards you as you are to them. And so it was kind of that dynamic. Do you not have that with your friends?
Well, it made me sick for a while, because, you know, the two, when they're girls and then as they grow, this feeling of, like, sometimes they'll hate each other, but then mm-hmm. they see each other and it's like they have to be connected, and yeah. the feeling of jealousy. And it made me think, like, do I hate my friends but love them? But certainly I think that element of jealousy in friend groups is something that maybe we don't talk about, that I was thinking about. Like,
we definitely don't with women, too.
Exactly, because we're, yeah. like, do you think that there's, do friendships have to have an element of jealousy or hatred to be passionate?
I don't know, probably not. But I just... they've always been in mine, like, because, yeah, I get jealous. I'm so jealous of them. And I have jealousy. Jealousy is like a problem, like, in any relationship. I'm just, like, insanely, weirdly jealous. Like, I don't, like, psychoanalyze myself. I think probably I didn't have a mother growing up, so I get so, like, fixated on people not loving me enough or being devoted, and then I become like this sort of I demand like this insane fidelity from my friends.
Well, speaking of mothers,
yeah,
there are no good mothers in this book.
Yeah.
Is that related? Like, where I thought, was that a purposeful thing? Was that the, like,
no, not at all. Like, I often talk, like, when I handed in my last book, The Lonely Hearts Hotel, my editor was like, oh, once again, there are characters without mothers. And I was like, oh my God, I always forget to put mothers in. Like, there are always characters without mothers. And I'm like, mothers, mothers. So this one, then, at least...
there are mothers.
There are mothers. They're not good mothers.
They're not good mothers.
But I'm trying to get them into the page.
Baby steps.
Come mothers, yeah. Because it seems like such an odd... like, for me, the experience of being a child is being abandoned in the world. So I always kind of... that's, too, one of the reasons I liked fiction so much, because it was so filled with abandoned children. And I was like, these are my people. Their mothers don't like them either, you know?
This conversation went dark, but the... but it's funny because you're laughing, and that's kind of what the book is like. It's like we're laughing and there's cake and it's decadent, but it's really dark, but mm-hmm. I'm smiling. And it's exploring all of these different power dynamics mm-hmm. within families, within class, within friendships, between men and women. And I was, you know, really interested in the class dynamics. Mm-hmm. It's set in Montreal. And there's the Golden Mile, the Bridal Path, where all the rich people live, and then the Squalid Mile, where this is where the people who work in the factories are, the brothels are. And can you tell me a little bit about you must have just done so much research for this and had the setting really come alive. Can you take me into that process at all?
Yeah, the research was actually really fun. There was kind of two levels of research, because I was doing a bit research on the French Revolution, because I wanted these Victorian girls to, each one had to be like Robespierre and the Marquis de Sade and whatnot, so I had to find sort of really interesting aspects of their personality that would somehow speak to being a woman, which is odd. But as for constructing the world, yeah, so like the Golden Mile was based on the Golden Square Mile in Montreal, which is still there, and they have these sort of illustrious mansions up there. Yeah, that's where the Trudeaus have a place. Every time I pass, I'm like, why? Give it back to the people. But it's neither here nor there. But so there's these gigantic mansions, and it was the Victorian era, so so much went into these houses, and they represented wealth. And that actually was really kind of easy to research because they documented themselves so incredibly well, as the upper class do. And and that was fun for the costumes. Like some of the things were harder to research because you had to look under, I mean, literally underneath, like underneath the clothes, like what would women be wearing to the bathroom? Like I didn't even know like how they dealt with their menstrual cycles or peed. So it's like a lot of times in my book, like they have their crinolines, which is those giant cages. So when they go to the bathroom, they'll topple over or they're always falling downstairs. Because it always like, in Victorian novels, I was like, how do they move with such ease in these dresses? So my characters are always like, I will tell you,
yes,
over they go. But then the squalid mile is quite different because it just doesn't exist anymore because it was created so kind of makeshift because at the time you had all these boats coming in filled with immigrants and Montreal was just being populated at this like exponential rate. And you had to build houses for them and they were sort of like right off the boats, like we have jobs for you at the factories, which had just sort of all been built. And so they made these little houses in neighborhoods along the canal and the river. But it was hard to find anything about them. And every time I found any little detail about them, though, it was so kind of crazy and tumultuous the way they lived. And it was so dirty. Everything, each detail is so dirty. So I called it like the squalid mile because it just like stank. And if you walked down the street with a dress, you would have to like shake off because it'd have like dead rats and hair brushes and like, I don't know what else. But and then I was researching the brothels of the time because I wanted to have a brothel. And that was fascinating too because then I really found out that the women who were sex workers at the time had just a much better quality of life than the women who were working in factories, and particularly mothers. Mothers had it the worst of all. I mean, it's like no surprise. Yeah, so that was interesting to me because they knew more about their health and they had access to medical care and just they had some time off and
it definitely
some
seems
agency
like-
too. They because at the time also if you were married you immediately became the property of somebody else. So it's also too if you wonder like in his Victorian novels there's often a figure of a sex worker, as they would call it, a prostitute. And the reason is because they had more agency. They're almost like the orphan. Whereas like the orphan literature is so easy to move around because there's no parents telling you what to do. And then the sex worker can move around because she doesn't have a husband telling her what to do.
Well, and again, no spoilers, but a character comes to that conclusion that, wait, if I get married, this person then is going to take my everything from me. As my mother's was taken by my father. And this like power dynamic between men and women it kind of goes throughout the book. I thought of, you know, George, who is a central character as well. And we can talk a little bit about George, but one of the things that comes up about George is George's, I guess today would be considered non-binary. Mm-hmm. And that a character says to them, you know, you're freed because you are not attracted to men. They cannot take your power. I mean, how did you explore the power dynamics between the genders through George?
That's a complicated question. Like, George kind of came to me fully formed. Like, I didn't really set out to have a kind of genderqueer character, but when I created George, that's how they appeared to me. And I mean, I don't know why this is all getting back to my mother, but let's go back to my mother. So my mother had left me when I was 7, and then I hadn't seen her for a few years, and then she kind of, came to visit me, and they were living in Provincetown, and they had changed their name to Abraham and was dressed in men's clothing and was living with women. And so it was just, that was part of my, so it was so natural to me, the idea of having, the idea of being able to transition. Mm-hmm. So because my mother had transitioned and was now a man, and then they were like, well, you can come stay with me in Provincetown for the summer, but whatever you do, don't tell anyone. You're my daughter. And then I was like, well, how are you gonna explain having like this 11-year-old? And she's like, we're friends, okay? So we went, I was like, we're friends. We met like at a, and then yeah, then they would go out and not invite me along. But the one time I got invited along, because all the lesbians in Provincetown used to have these Trivial Pursuit matches, so then I memorized every Trivial Pursuit card so I could have my mother take me along. And then my mother was like, this is Heather, she's a genius at Trivial Pursuit.
We met
on a train.
Yeah.
So I think so that George has a bit of that, like they dress very, very much like my mother did. But it was also, I was really exploring femininity in the novel and the violence of femininity and the idea that just because you have these sort of what are considered feminine attributes does not make you passive whatsoever. In fact, in a lot of cases, in my book, that makes you psychotic. Like they're psychopaths, very beautiful psychopaths. And George is actually the moral compass mm-hmm. of the novel, who actually has kindness, and who doesn't. And they're always kind of questioning these sort of gender roles and what it is to. I mean, they wouldn't know how to say it at the time, but to be a good feminist, because they're all. They're all like terrible feminists, a lot of them. Like especially like Marie Antoine, who's based on Marie Antoinette, who basically like, they're so ambitious, some of them. What's that noise?
I think that's the mic. I don't know if it's...
Is the pouring the water?
There we go.
So Marie, because take Marie, she becomes this, you know, this factory owner as she grows up, and she accumulates all this wealth, and she becomes this crazed, like cutthroat mogul, and then, you know, but then the women from the squalid miles start to sort of like creep up the hill in this revolutionary fervor to her. And one of the accusations is that as a woman, once you got to the top, you weren't supposed to just become as bad as the men. You were supposed right. to knock down this patriarchy and help for everybody. But Marie's like, "Who are you? You're poor. Go away." So they're all like. So George is a bit the intersectional one.
I loved the setup with Marie, how, you know, you said empathy, and I just, passages that I'm highlighting here of her father realizing, like watching her interact with factory workers when she's a child. Mm-hmm. Because when she's a child, she's like, when I take over the factory, I'm going to give everyone cakes every day,
yeah.
and I'm going to get to know them all and you know, I let them know how appreciated they are. And then as the father is talking about, like, that he realizes she doesn't have any empathy, that she cannot picture herself as one of them. And I thought that was really interesting, that dynamic of the people we think we're going to be when we
yeah.
grow up. I don't know, the person that she becomes, that she then, you know, the workers look at her and like, oh, you're a woman, you're going to back us. But she betrays them. She actually uses the fact that she's a woman. What are you, I don't know, were you thinking of anything current today in that dynamic of women getting to the very top and maybe not
yeah.
helping people along?
Yeah, because that was such a conversation and something that, you know, it's sort of this big issue in feminism today, and this idea of like, girl, like the sort of current reaction to that girl boss feminism, where it was always just like, break the glass ceiling, and then you can be just like a man also. And then it's sort of like, but that was not exactly what feminism was about, was it? And then it just becomes like, then you have women from certain classes or certain backgrounds who get to the top, and then everybody else is kind of squashed. So yeah, I was really interested in that conversation.
And George also kind of took part in that conversation with another character, where it's this revolution. We're going to get to the revolution because that's kind of the current throughout this whole thing. Mm-hmm. But where a character wants to kind of like, you know, go after the power, and it's like, wait, are you trying to, is this about equality for all of us, or is this about you just taking that seat? Mm-hmm. And I guess I was curious reading it, like your thoughts on where we are now. This is another huge moment of income inequality. I think that's one of the biggest issues playing out right now. Mm-hmm. Are we on the verge of a revolution?
What kind of question is that for me? I don't know. It does definitely seem like something has to give, there's so many issues. I think something has to give in Canada just with, so off topic, but the housing market, or maybe it's not on
no,
topic.
No, it's not, because it's housing. On topic, yeah.
Because, it's just become impossible for people. It's creating this insane disparity that it becomes impossible. You're having, again, the landowner class and the renter class, which was actually like the source of many revolutions, where people, there was no way to become a landowner, and we've actually created that now. And it's frustrating to me, even from the beginning of the pandemic. Like, I live in Montreal, so the beginning of the pandemic, my rent to now, my rent is about 120% higher. So it's like more than doubled.
Right.
But because it happened in Montreal, it went like crazy. But it's not only that I'm paying that much extra to the landowner, but that takes it out of the rest of, like, shouldn't I be, it's like COVID, we're supposed to recover and buy books.
Yeah.
And go to plays. And it's like, this is money I was intending to give to artists.
Right.
So.
I thought when I was reading this, it's like, this is a period in time that maybe we haven't seen in a very long time. This huge disparity between
it's
the
just
owning
impossible.
Class and the working class. And that was, I mean, throughout the novel, this current of revolution. I mean, obviously we have the main character, Marie Antoinette, we have a Robespierre. Can you talk to me about Sadie, because sexual revolution and embracing of a woman's sexuality as a way to power. Talk to me about Sadie, because she's kind of the conduit here.
Okay, so Sadie is the artist in the book. And Sadie was actually the most peculiar. There's always a character in the book that makes me like question myself and find out things about myself. And I think Sadie was that person. So Sadie was based on the Marquis de Sade, and who was alive at that time in the French Revolution. And he was, I mean, I'm sure you all know who he is, but just in case you don't, or give you a refresher, was this famous or infamous pornographer, and wrote these huge texts about that were pornographic and banned throughout France. But what he was interested in was absolute liberty and absolute freedom, and how that could be achieved, and breaking down of any sort of societal taboo. Of course, then he was also this horrific person who was repeatedly imprisoned for kidnapping and just every sort of heinous crime. He was a horrible person. However, and he was quite brutal to many young women, particularly maids, which is why, I mean, you can imagine if you're an aristocrat and you go to jail for how you treat a maid, like how bad it had to have
right.
been. But his text became so influential through the 20th century. And then what was so fascinating to me, like the reason I had been thinking about the Marquis de Sade a lot, was because so many feminists I admired had sort of counterintuitively embraced his writing, because the women in the Marquis de Sade's texts who are virtuous and sort of follow and behave in a way that, normal, rash, like, I guess virtuous a good person would, they get punished. And the women who don't care anything about morality and are disgusted by maternity, they get rewarded. Because the Marquis de Sade was also, whenever there's a woman who's pregnant in his work or is giving birth, he looks on it as this horrific, repulsive act. And then, so surprisingly, the 20th century feminists were like, well, Marquis de Sade is interesting because he's looking at the woman's body as something outside of being a mother. So they were exploring it in these ways. So then for me, I was like, oh, I just had to have a character that was a woman who was based on the Marquis de Sade and doing, and so she starts writing these elaborate pornographic texts that kind of speak to female desire and what, and seeing them all from a female, from a woman's perspective, and they become very popular. But like the Marquis de Sade, I don't know if I'm babbling, but anyways. So the Marquis de Sade, he was liberated by the French revolutionaries. He was in the Bastille when they happened to storm it, and they were like, you are free. And he was like, fantastic. They're like, why don't you write some speeches for us? But meanwhile, he was the worst aristocrat of them all, like sort of like, everybody was having their heads cut off. Like, nobody was comparable to the Marquis de Sade, but they were like, but people love when you speak out loud, because he was eloquent, and he had this beautiful, he was just so gifted in with plays and writing, so he would write these magnificent speeches until finally the revolutionaries were like, you know, this is not right, this guy. He's just not right, yeah? He can write a beautiful speech for us, but like, he's just so corrupt and awful, and Sadie has that. Sadie is questioned by the revolutionaries, like, what is your intent? And it also made me wonder, even, what is my intent as a writer? Because they question Sadie, because Sadie goes down to the brothel and she just kind of mines it for research and subjects for her writing and metaphors and these like wonderful tales. And I was like, how corrupt is it to be a novelist in some sense? Because you just go to all these areas of life and steal stories for your own, just to spin these tales.
I'm so afraid of going off on a tangent. What's the name of that? That's the kidney story. Do you know the one I'm talking about? The stealing the kidney?
No, the woman who gave away a kidney.
And then the...
What's that?
I'm going to spare you all this side thing. Google kidney stolen literary writers. Celeste Ng is in there somewhere.
Oh no, she gave away a kidney.
I know, and then someone wrote
about
it.
But then she bragged about it, and all the other writers wrote about it.
And there was a question of like writing is stealing someone else's stories, and how. Anyway, I'm just gonna sidestep that question to go back to this one.
Oh no, the question was, did she give away the kidney just to say she gave away the kidney?
And then the question was, but the writer...
What's her intent? What's the right intent of any writer?
Are you capitalizing on... You're stealing this person's story and writing it as your own.
Oh, right. I forgot that aspect.
That was the thing. The ethics of it. But, I mean, with Sadie, she writes these pornographic materials. Mm-hmm. And as the women in her life read them, and then eventually a much wider audience reads them, she sees them as, like, this is the power that they are harnessing. Mm-hmm. That's, like... stoking this revolution. And there's this really interesting passage that I could not find as I was quickly flipping through here. I thought I postmarked it, but the female orgasm, it like framed in this really interesting way that actually, you know, we think of historically as like, well, women are like a vessel for children and that's what we are. It's like, actually, like the male orgasm is just for procreating, mm-hmm. but women are orgasming just for fun.
Exactly. We don't actually need to orgasm. So our orgasm is totally like perverse and for our own delight.
That's just something that jumped off the page at me.
That's what Sadie's very fascinated. Because she's like, if we understand like what it is, because if you have this conversation of what women actually like in bed or what they fantasize about, and you're more free about that, then you understand yourself better to like open yourself up.
And it seemed like whenever the men in this book were having sex, they were getting people pregnant. Mm-hmm. And then there's this little army of Marys. Because it talks about the illegitimate children and that Mary was a very common name. So I think there are just like literally a whole bunch of Marys that are now getting revolutionized and ready to rise up. Can you talk to me about the Marys? Because it was kind of terrifying, this army.
That was actually, I liked,
you guys are like, what is in this book?
That was one of the parts I really liked writing because, okay, so it's like Marie Antoine's father is a philanderer, in a sense. He doesn't want to get, his wife dies when Marie's quite young. So he doesn't want to get married, but he just wants to have sex. So he's constantly having sex with maids, and the maids are kind of always, they're having to constantly change the maids because the maids, they'll always occasionally be, you know, the maids always go fatal attraction as women do when we're rejected, like to hell with it. Why not make a show? Yeah. So they'll like show up in the yard or like throwing themselves in the pond. Anyway, so there's this one scene where I just envision all of Louis's illegitimate children like around the city doing different things. And that was really fun too because I had to find their little occupations, and they have such strange occupations
for
children.
A matchmaker? Anyway.
Matchmaker, yeah. With that, it was a lot of those women ended up being poisoned because the phosphorescent poisoned them. There's one who goes and collects leeches, and
oh my god,
one who gets the rats for the rat, like because they dogs chasing rats were very popular. That was a wonderful, wonderful thing they loved to watch in my squalid mile. And in Victorian times, they're very popular. So you have this one little girl whose job is to go with her father and just collect rats to sell by the basket. So I found them the most macabre, little fascinating Victorian professions. And so there's just this kind of interlude in the middle of the book where we stop all the action and then you just see the little Marys and they're strange, like coming out of chimneys and then like blinking their eyes and stuff.
And there is this, you know, this moment of the women kind of rising up, and there's like these so many great little passages of the men, you know, walking home and they're like, is someone behind me? Is the woman behind me? I don't know. I like,
yeah,
am I imagining it? And just like flipping the script. And I mean, I don't know if you can talk about that, but we're almost out of time here because I do want to open up to questions. Maybe just, I guess, actually wrapping up this side. I thought it was fascinating too that you really focused so much on women working. The women were working, like we think of, I think, we don't think of women working.
Especially the industrial times.
Right, but they had some of the most dangerous jobs, women and children. And that when they stopped working, the factories shut down.
Yeah.
And I mean, what were you saying when you were focusing on that in the book?
Well, I've always despised that sort of second wave feminist idea that, you know, women have to like fight to make the choice to go out and work, because I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. Women have always worked in every, like they've worked and worked, and even the Industrial Revolution, like the factories were full of women, and they would have little daycares where they brought and just dropped the babies in. And as you were saying, like young girls would have these very precarious jobs because they were tiny and had the little fingers, so they would kind of jump in between machines to clean them, and they would get crushed, and all the women would just go to work. So I hate this, like, women should get jobs. I'm like, what are you talking about? And where are these men who pay for everything? I don't. Maybe it exists, but it's just not. It's not true to my reality, you know. Like, I'm lucky if I can get a guy to buy me a cup of coffee. I'm like, will you pay for me to stay at home? They're like, no. So it's sort of this very particular existence that feminism tends to speak to. So I really wanted to reclaim that, like, women's place in the Industrial Revolution, which was really, like, at every sort of...
And in the workforce in
general. Every part of the workforce, yeah.